Hi everyone, I'm Neil McAvoy, member of the Welsh Parliament for South Wales Central and leader of Wales's brand new political party, Propel. I want to put another video out to explain why I oppose lockdowns. First of all, I want to say that I was the first politician in Wales to send staff home last year because I wanted to keep them safe. Every other office was open and my staff were at home. I took and take the virus very seriously. I want to end Welsh lockdowns because I want to save lives and restore freedom. I'm not saying open up completely immediately, but I am saying that we need to live with this virus. It's not going anywhere soon. We need policies which do the least harm. In this video, we're going to be looking at issues of trust, asking whether or not lockdowns are effective, and also exploring who really benefits. Let's start with trust. The most obvious thing for me is that if lockdowns work so well, we wouldn't have needed three of them. We needed a second lockdown because the first lockdown didn't work. We needed a third lockdown because the second lockdown didn't work. And I think it's pretty well guaranteed we'll need a fourth lockdown because the third one will have been said not to have worked. And that's because lockdowns do not completely get rid of the virus. So there's always the potential that it will come back. The reality also is that lockdown is a really extreme policy, untested, unknown, with a lot of guesswork. In spite of this, some people want to blame the failures of lockdowns on the public and on people for supposedly not following the rules. That's something that the First Minister, Mark Drakeford, has done himself. But it's really not my experience. I've seen the overwhelming majority of people really try, really change their lives, not seeing friends, not going out, and not going about their daily business as they used to do. If we want to talk about not following the rules, then we'd really need to start at the top. Professor Neil Ferguson, formerly one of the main scientific advisors on SAGE, and he was one of the key people advising the government to implement lockdowns. Anyway, Professor Lockdown, as he was called, had to resign because he was caught repeatedly breaking the lockdown rules. He was having an affair. We also had Scotland's Chief Medical Officer, Catherine Calderwood, who also had to resign because she was breaking the rules by visiting her second home. In Scotland, she was actually the face of the stay-at-home campaign. Most famously, we had Dominic Cummings, the Prime Minister's former advisor, doing what the hell he was doing. It seemed to involve driving the length of England while infected with COVID, and then driving to a tourist site with his whole family in the car to test his eyesight.
We agreed that we should go for a short drive to see if I could drive safely.
It just so happened to be his wife's birthday that day. The Sky News reporter, Kay Burley, was suspended after being caught breaking lockdown rules at a birthday party. That was after she publicly called out many others for breaking lockdown. Closer to home in Wales, we've seen Mark Drakeford travelling to Skewen for a visit that wasn't socially distanced. The Health Minister engaging in a questionable bit of lunch with his family. The Deputy Transport Minister travelling between his family home in Penarth and his second home in the Llanelli constituency. And most infamously, the booze-up in the Welsh Parliament attended by Labour and Conservative politicians. Now, these are just not any people. These were the UK government's main scientific advisor, who was pressing for lockdowns, Scotland's chief medical officer, who was also supporting lockdowns, the Prime Minister's right-hand man, who was implementing lockdowns, one of the UK's main news reporters, who was enforcing the lockdown mantra, and the leaders of Wales's government and official opposition, who vote for lockdowns. Most of them were not engaged in anything noble or moral at the time that they did what they did, having affairs, visiting second homes, celebrating their birthday, being Dominic Cummings. They just did what they wanted to do. So that's my first point that I need to get out of the way. If these people were so convinced that lockdowns are essential, knowing how much damage lockdowns cause, why were they so willing to either break or at least bend lockdown rules? For no good reason at all. This is an issue of trust, and that trust between the public and the decision makers has been broken. Now let's look at whether or not lockdowns are effective. And by effective, we're talking about a whole host of things, such as the impact on mental health, on children's education, on people's livelihoods, on people's quality of life, and of course, on people's health. I'll start with health because this is clearly the most important factor in deciding about lockdowns. I cannot find any definitive proof that lockdowns save lives, or to be more specific, that they save more lives than they cost. The Office for National Statistics, which is the UK government's stats agency, submitted a report to SAGE, the Scientific Advisory Group for Emergencies, in July 2020 and said the following. When morbidity is taken into account, the estimates for the health impacts from a lockdown and lockdown-induced recessions are greater in terms of quality-adjusted life years than the direct COVID-19 deaths. What the paper is saying is that because of lockdowns and the economic recession they cause, in the long term, we are projected to live less of our lives in a healthy state. And that loss of healthy life is of greater impact than the direct lives lost through COVID. It should be noted that this paper is comparing a mitigated scenario with health protection measures in place, not lockdowns versus doing nothing. If we look into the research on the effectiveness of lockdowns in stopping spread of virus infection, then again, there's plenty of research to suggest that they are ineffective. A research study by Ben David and others, which was partly funded by Stanford University, that's one of the top universities on earth, looked into the effect of the most restrictive non-pharmaceutical interventions, that is lockdown, for controlling the spread of the coronavirus. The study examined 10 countries, including England, and came to the conclusion that implementing any NPIs was associated with significant reductions in case growth, but that we do not find significant benefits on case growth of more restrictive NPIs. So what the paper is saying is that implementing non-pharmaceutical interventions, such as social distancing measures, did lead to a reduction in cases in most countries. But implementing the most severe measures, which is to say lockdown measures, it did not lead to a reduction in cases. In a peer-reviewed paper in the medical journal The Lancet, Devi Sridhar and others argue that lockdowns are not the answer to bringing COVID under control. And she observes that lockdown and other extreme restrictions cannot be sustained in the long term. I think it's important to remind ourselves that these extreme restrictions should be seen as such. If you're in Wales and many other countries, then it is currently illegal for you to walk outside your own house if you do not have a reasonable excuse to do so. It's starting to feel almost normal at times, but it really isn't. Nonetheless, there are a vocal group of people out there who are so extreme and dogmatic in supporting lockdowns that they can give the impression that there is absolute certainty about the effectiveness of lockdowns. You'll find them commenting on social media, insulting people as idiots or COVIDiots, COVID deniers, which is a deliberate attempt to link people who question lockdowns with Holocaust deniers. They scream about listening to the scientists or doctors, but the truth is there is no consensus among scientists or doctors about the effectiveness of lockdowns. In an honest opinion piece in MedPage Today, medical doctor and master of public health, Vinay Prasad argues that whether and to what degree restrictions work and under what circumstances is a set of scientific questions. Let me be the first to admit that I simply do not know the answers. Moreover, I believe the real answers will take years to emerge. And to see how much uncertainty there is, we only need to look at the Welsh Government's lockdown risk assessments. It took me a long time to get these, and it was only after more than 170,000 of you watched my video on the fact that the Welsh Health Minister was taking months to get back to my COVID questions that I finally got some responses from him. So thanks to you all for helping on that. In the risk assessment written by the government's technical advisory group on COVID-19, the Welsh equivalent of SAGE, the group says that closing non-essential retail is likely to have a very minimal impact on the R rate. That's the reproduction rate of the virus. They claim closing pubs and bars will only have a moderate impact. Closing gyms, leisure centres and fitness venues will have a low to moderate impact. On school closures, the risk assessments claim that the impact on the R rate could be 0.2 or 0.5. But they also state that they have low confidence in saying this, and there is a lot of debate around the impact of schools on transmission. The closure of childcare settings is projected to have a small impact on virus transmission. Local travel restrictions are claimed to have a low to moderate impact. But again, they have low confidence on whether that's the case. What's important to note from all the Welsh Government projections is that the extreme restrictions introduced by the Welsh Government are, for the most part, projected to have only low to moderate impacts on virus transmission. But that the government also has low confidence in almost all of its predictions. Dr. Roland Salmon, a retired epidemiologist who was actually the former director of Communicable Disease Surveillance Centre in Wales, has said on lockdowns that they're doomed to failure and would only bring cost without benefits. That's all very different to the certainty which some of the lockdown extremists like to paint things. The government does also make some predictions about the impact of lockdowns and the costs that Dr. Salmon mentions, and they are damning. They claim, and I'm quoting the risk assessment, long-term lifetime scarring effect on socioeconomic outcomes will result in lower incomes, increased risks of unemployment, of poor health, and of premature mortality. They also say that the nature of employment in the most affected sectors means that effects will tend to worsen inequalities. The most affected tend to be low paid, in insecure employment, and young people. More broadly, recessions tend to impact most severely on people who are already disadvantaged. On businesses, the government predicts ongoing open-ended restrictions will have a high cost and even in the short term will affect long-term viability of businesses. For school children, the risk assessment argues that on lockdowns, there is strong evidence for a range of socio-economic harms to children, both over short and long run. They also acknowledge that there is strong evidence that harms disproportionately affect deprived children, and therefore also children from many minority groups, and that these harms are likely to include an increase in adverse childhood experiences, ACEs, which research indicates can result in trauma and attachment issues and severe harm over the long term. On forcing people to stay at home, the Welsh Government observes that reduced social activity will increase loneliness and isolation and reduce well-being and harm medical and potentially physical, including mental health, alcohol and drug misuse, violence and abusive behaviour, and an increased level of physical inactivity. So you hear all that and you have to ask, what on earth are we doing? We adopted a completely untried and unprecedented measure of extreme lockdown restrictions. There is huge debate over whether the restrictions actually work. The government has come to the conclusion that these extreme restrictions will only have a low to moderate impact on the virus, although they have only low confidence in most of their predictions. But they are fairly certain that lockdowns will have a big impact on businesses, will lead to life-scarring effects through lower incomes, unemployment, poor health and death. Mental and physical health will be impacted. Drug, alcohol and domestic abuse will increase. There will be a range of harms to children, including an increase in adverse childhood experiences, leading to trauma and attachment issues. And the people who are most likely to suffer are the already poor, ethnic minorities and deprived children. But here we are, in an ongoing and open-ended lockdown, after being forced to stay at home for close to 200 days in total over the past 12 months. If we look beyond Wales to the impact of lockdowns in the rest of the world, then the potential for significant harm is even more stark. In an article in The Lancet, which is a world-leading medical journal, authors included Richard Sullivan, who is Professor of Global Health at King's College London, argue that, like UNICEF and others, we believe that lockdowns kill people through disruption of health services and deprivation of livelihoods. At the bottom end of the global pile, recession is not just a matter of having less, it's a matter of life and death. And they're not alone. In a speech to the United Nations Security Council, the executive director of the World Food Programme told ambassadors that there is a grave danger that many people will die from the broader economic and social consequences of COVID than from the virus itself, especially in Africa. And the last thing we need is to have the cure to be worse than the disease itself. The London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine has researched the impact of immunisation centres actually being closed down during lockdown in many countries, meaning routine immunisation against preventable diseases like measles, meningitis, pneumonia, just stopped happening. They calculated that for every COVID-19 death that may be prevented through closing the centres, as many as 80 children may die due to a lack of routine immunisations. In an article called More Harm Than Good by authors including the former Director of Global Health at Imperial College London, which was posted by the Centre for Global Development, Calypso Chalkidu, and others recognised that lockdown policies have consequences through disrupting supply chains, redirecting people and money to the COVID-19 response, and preventing people from seeking and accessing care. They go on to argue that it should not be a choice between doing nothing and lockdowns. It should be about appraising different policy options, using a more holistic approach. That's all very different to how some of the more fanatical supporters of lockdown like to portray things. The people I've just named are not far-right conspiracy theorists. They're UNICEF, the UN World Food Programme, and professors and researchers of global health from top universities. They all have grave concerns about some of the global impacts of lockdowns, which will include people dying from poverty, starvation, and from other illnesses and diseases that could have been prevented. If the goal of lockdowns is to save lives, then it could be the most disastrous policy failure in generations. But these impacts are also taking place in Wales, as well as across Europe. In a letter to me, the Welsh Health Minister, Vaughan Gethin, confirmed that during 2020, the number of people waiting over 9 months for health treatment in the NHS had increased by over 1,000% in several health boards, with over 120,000 people now waiting that long, up from under 30,000 before the pandemic. You can see this rise in most areas of the NHS. For example, the Director of Planning and Performance at One Health Board in South Wales confirmed to me that during the summer of 2020, COVID levels were much reduced and intensive care bed rates were operating at occupancies close to normal. And yet at another South Wales Health Board, they sent me figures to show that in June, July and August 2020, they managed just 6 knee procedures compared to 138 over the same period the year before. Similarly, for hip procedures, they managed only 14 compared to 135 the year before. With minimal COVID patients, ICU beds at normal levels, and no vaccine rollout to redirect staff at that time, it's unclear to me why there would have been such a dramatic drop in procedures. Clearly, missing knee and hip procedures is a painful and life-altering situation for many people, having to suffer from those conditions. But these huge delays in treatment and people simply being too fearful to access healthcare also have life-threatening consequences. Betsy Cadwell of the Health Board in North Wales was so concerned about this that they issued a press release stating that their health professionals are increasingly concerned that people are failing to seek urgent treatment for fear of catching the virus. They noted that the number of people attending Welsh emergency departments has fallen by up to 50% since the start of the coronavirus pandemic. Dr. Ash Basu, consultant in emergency medicine at Wrexham Mailer Hospital, said, "Since the start of the pandemic, we've seen a significant drop in patients presenting with genuine emergencies, such as chest pains that could be symptoms of a heart attack, diabetic emergencies, and strokes. This is concerning for us who work in the emergency departments. Anyone who delays seeking treatment is putting their long-term health at risk." The Office for National Statistics has confirmed this serious problem. They estimated that in England, during the first lockdown, 41% of the excess deaths linked to COVID were actually the result of missed medical care rather than the virus itself. This really is extraordinary. What we have done is put all our medical eggs in one COVID basket, and the result has been tens of thousands of deaths. I believe these deaths were unnecessary because lockdowns are unnecessary. There's no definitive evidence to show that they're more effective than holistic social distancing measures, but lockdowns do lead to significant extra deaths. With that in mind, and given the outrageous impact of lockdowns, we now have to move to the last part of this video, which is to ask who actually benefits. There's really two elements to looking at who benefits from the government's response to the pandemic: what's happening globally and what's happening closer to home. Closer to home, there's been rampant profiteering during the pandemic. Matt Hancock, the Secretary of State for Health in Westminster, was found to have broken the law after failing to publish details of billions of pounds of lucrative COVID contracts, mainly relating to personal protective equipment or PPE. It's also been documented that there was a VIP channel for approved government firms to get COVID contracts. The 493 companies on this high priority list were 10 times more likely to win contracts than the 15,000 other businesses who applied for them. And it seems that many of the VIP companies were politically connected, At one stage, a contract was awarded to the UK Health Secretary's next-door neighbour. At the time, his business was supplying cups and takeaway boxes to catering firms, and he had no experience in producing medical equipment. Now it's supplying 2 million medical-grade COVID testing vials a week via a distributor contracted to the NHS. He denied he profited from his connection to the Health Minister, but he's now under investigation by the UK Medicines Agency. £22 billion has been spent on the NHS track and trace system alone, a system that's been ridiculed as a failure. As has often been pointed out, that's a sum of money more than it cost to build the Channel Tunnel. Of course, much of this money has been going to private companies and not local health boards. So it's clear to me that there's been serious nepotism in the UK when it's come to the virus and a staggering waste of enormous sums of money. But what's happening globally? It's difficult at this point not to bring up the Great Reset, which gets spoken about a lot during the pandemic. So what is it? Well, it's an agenda dreamt up by the influential and transnational World Economic Forum, or WEF. For those who don't know, the WEF is a kind of global think tank headed by Klaus Schwab that is most famous for its annual gathering of billionaires and political leaders in Davos, Switzerland. The Great Reset is their current agenda for transforming the world in light of the pandemic. Obviously, a gathering of the world's wealthiest and most powerful people to an event that the public is excluded from raises a lot of questions. And I don't know who's doing the PR for the WEF, but the Great Reset just sounds sinister. Some of the predictions that the WEF has made seem even more sinister. One of the predictions is that by 2030, you'll own nothing and you'll be happy. Whatever you want, you'll rent, and it'll be delivered by drone. Everything about that raises alarm bells for me. Machines will be doing our jobs, and this idea that we'll own nothing and just rent things doesn't really address the issue of who will actually own the things you're renting. Somebody will. And those people are likely to become incredibly powerful and wealthy. It's pretty clear here what we're being reduced to. Consumers. Machines do the work. You own nothing. Just keep spending money, keep consuming, and be happy. We can partly see this change already. One of the groups to have undoubtedly benefited have been the supermarkets. They've been allowed to stay open throughout. And for those shielding or too afraid to shop in store, they've facilitated a rapid move to online shopping and home deliveries. And what's been the outcome of that? One of the UK's largest supermarkets, Asda, who's owned by Walmart, has just announced 5,000 jobs at risk. Explaining why, Asda's chief executive, Roger Burnley, said the pandemic has accelerated change across the retail sector, especially the shift towards grocery home shopping, and our priority is to serve customers in the way they want to shop with us. It's not really a case of necessarily wanting to shop online now, it's more a case of people having to shop online because they're too worried to go outside or because they're locked down. I think we can all see what's coming. The move to automation and online shopping has been happening for some time, and our high streets have been suffering. Where I am, in Cardiff, whole blocks of shops are just boarded up now, in the centre of town. You can see the centralisation of money and power in all sectors of the economy. Small-scale family farming is being replaced by industrial agriculture. Local coffee shops have been replaced by global chains. Local independent shops have been replaced by supermarkets and chain stores. It doesn't really matter where you live, the shops are the same. I could be in Cardiff or Birmingham or Glasgow, wherever. I'll be shopping in the same corporate shops. Now we're even moving past that to all shop in the same places online while getting our information from a handful of social media platforms. And the result has been a number of people who've become spectacularly rich. The Guardian reported in December that the richest 10 people on earth had increased their wealth by 400 billion since the pandemic began. Just 10 people. And that's no surprise. These tech and software billionaires are the founders of companies like Amazon, Google, Facebook, Microsoft, who all cater for home shopping or home working. In the case of Bill Gates, not only does he have a significant impact on the world's software and technology, he also has a huge influence on global health. He's been the world's largest donor to the World Health Organization, and he also happens to have enormous investments in pharmaceutical companies like Pfizer, who made the first coronavirus vaccine. This led Naomi Klein, author of No Logo and The Shock Doctrine, to write of the very real, though not new, problem of Bill Gates' singular power over global health policy. Is it right that one billionaire has so much influence over world health, as well as having enormous financial interests in health companies? I don't think so. I'm not suggesting that any of these people named are deliberately pushing for these lockdowns, but I don't want this pandemic being used as a way for a handful of businesses to benefit from their political connections. To reset the world to a place of so-called happy consumers being serviced by machines, where severe inequality is made worse. I want power and wealth to be less concentrated. But the opposite is happening now because of lockdown. While local independent shops are forced to stay shut, the multinationals and tech giants are the ones trading and altering our habits. So let's remind ourselves who has not benefited from these lockdowns. Those already in poverty in Wales and around the world, who have been forced to stay at home and rely on reduced government payouts. As predicted by the Welsh Government in their risk assessment, many people are lonelier, they're more isolated, more are unemployed, more businesses have gone under, they're unhealthier, they will live less of their lives in a healthy state, drug, alcohol and domestic abuse increase, mental health is in crisis, children will suffer, including scarring effects from trauma and attachment issues, and people are dying from missed medical diagnosis and poverty. I just want to briefly look at the alternative narrative to what I'm saying. It is possible that short lockdowns could have been effective, and I understand why some people advocate for them. If lockdowns come early and efforts are then made to keep the virus out of countries, they may be effective. But that's not what happened in the UK. We locked down late, and the Welsh Health Minister has confirmed to me that absolutely nobody has been tested for COVID when arriving at Welsh airports. The truth is that the virus is here, and it's been here for an entire year now. The chance for an effective and short lockdown at the beginning was missed, although it could be that a lockdown would never have been effective. The Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, has now conceded that whenever we ease the lockdown, whether it's today or in 6 or 9 months, we've got to be realistic and accept that there will be more infections, more hospitalizations, and therefore, sadly, more deaths, just as there are every year with flu. Even if we sustain the lockdown indefinitely, which would itself cost lives and do immeasurable harm to our children, we would not be able to eradicate this disease. So what did we do these lockdowns for? Did we save lives? I don't think we did. And research shows that lockdowns and fear have led to many additional deaths. Did we protect the health service? Again, I don't think so. The NHS is in crisis every winter. If you look at 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019, every winter for years now, the health service is under real strain. And that is largely because of underfunding and also because of the seasonal nature of viruses. In the winter of 2017-2018, in Scotland, excess deaths were up 75% on the year before. There was a significant spike, largely due to influenza and pneumonia. But there was no lockdown. What we've done through our reaction to coronavirus is to create a phenomenal backlog of people with health complaints that will take years for the NHS to recover from. It's a medical tsunami waiting to happen. It's essential now that this third prolonged lockdown ends and we do not return to it. We've got to take sensible precautions to live with the virus because it's not going away. Its spread is now reducing across the world, whether countries are locked down or not, whether they are vaccinated or not. That suggests that SARS-CoV-2 is following the pattern of the many respiratory viruses that have come before it. It's a seasonal virus and should be treated as such. Instead, so many of us are still suffering from the prolonged and draconian limits on our freedoms, movements and social contacts that have ever been implemented in human history. The most important thing now is to fight the virus in a sensible way. Not to do nothing, but to use measures like social distancing and shielding the vulnerable that are as effective at limiting deaths, but do not also cause deaths. We simply cannot continue to lock down nations for months on end, every time a seasonal virus appears, because the costs associated with lockdowns are just too high.